so sexy like you always do, but don't even know. At some point you're gonna smile at me, and it just feels like a war. And the night is getting closer, baby, I just don't know. Getting close to me, I just wanna come over.
So come into bed, so
yes, are you ready? It's gonna be crazy today. We have something totally new. Stan was actually telling you before, but this is something. Who was in Berlin in February? Well, it will be even better than Berlin, so get ready. Erase this recording. Oh, okay. No, it's something new, I said. So let's go ready. It is a sold out 1 hour only. No, in an hour event, Laura, something. It's a little bit more than an hour. I will guide you through the moment. So I'm going to explain you everything in a moment. But first of all, before we start and have the producers pitching their projects powered by AI forecasts with a human jury, I'm going to introduce to you in a second. Before we start, stay tuned. I want to present you the human brain behind all of this. And the human brain behind all of this, you know him, it's Sammy. He's the founder of Largo.ai. He's also, of course, also the CEO. It's a Switzerland-based company, and they provide data-assisted intelligence to the audiovisual industry. Well, you know that. Who do know that? No, you know it, because it is really their event here. And Sammy is really he's great, because he has a background in computer science and also, at the same time, in the film industry. So he's a PhD brain in computer vision from a Swiss University, and not a bad one. And he has also directed short films, and he's also the president of the Hoche Film Awards next to Lausanne. So he's really surfing these two spheres, and okay, well, that's not a hazard that we are here today. So Sammy, I would say, come on stage and tell them a little bit more about what's happening and we can expect today. Thank you.
Thank you very much, AC. Hello, everybody. Welcome. It's great to have second time this event in Cannes. And last year, we had also a full house event. It's great to see the big crowd today as well. So I will give you a bit information about how to read AI results. So for each project, we will see the presentation, and then jury will make their comment. And then you will see AI results for the projects. Probably some of you have already seen the results, similar results in other events, but let me explain still quickly. At the top, you will see genre evaluation of the stories by artificial intelligence. Here, each color represents a different genre. And this peak and values, it shows the change over the story. A peak here means like something important is happening over here. If you get something flat, that means the pacing is low in that content. Then here below, we have these character relationships. Here, of course, you cannot read the names, but at least you can a bit understand the dynamics of the story. Here we can see that there's a complicated character dynamics inside this film. The size of circles indicates the importance of the characters, and the thickness of edges, this shows the level of interaction between the characters. Then you will have the lead actor, and then if AI is commenting on that, you will see a match rate that is indicated by AI. If it's higher, that means it sees there's a higher potential of the success with that cast. And then on the left side, you see all the financials. You'll see total expected revenue that is predicted, and gross revenue to budget ratio, total ROI, ROI without soft money, and ROI for investors. I think we have a bit more explanation for that. So one thing to note that, so this is just a prediction for certain assumptions, because you have story, but then together with that you have budget, P&A, casts. So these are coming for that specific set of parameters. You will see these parameters on the bottom right side of the presentations. So quick thing, so gross revenue to budget ratio, revenue divided by total production budget, total ROI, net revenue minus total production budget divided by production budget. And here something differently, here we remove soft money. That's actually something mostly for European projects. It's a soft money you don't need to pay back. It becomes easier to have positive ROI. And lastly, we have also ROI for investors. So if investors are filling the gap, what will be the potential return for the film? Okay, so I hope this is clear for everybody.
How many producers do we have in the room? Yes, so we know what we're talking about, right? We don't need to explain you return on investment ratios. Good, yeah.
Okay, so do we have... Okay, one more thing. So I think you all got these flyers for Largo.ai Connect. If you want to see more detailed analysis of these projects, you can connect to Largo.ai Connect. You will need a passcode you should have on the cards that you are having at your seat. If you don't have these cards, you can get from our team, from Kili or Celine, who you are sitting in front. I think that's all from my side, so we can continue.
Yes, let's go on. That's wonderful. So I think it's very clear for everybody. So that's how the machine has analyzed everything, right? But we have humans, I was saying. So we are going to introduce them. And I'm going to start with Won Soon Shin. She's a consultant and co-production expert at Hanmac Culture Group in Korea. And she has... She has extensive knowledge. You can take a seat. She has extensive knowledge in the marketing and distribution from throwing film in Korea, but she has been also working with such companies like Paramount Pictures, DreamWorks Animation. She was a director at an international film festival for strategies of film and international marketing. So I would say we have here a good human brain to help us make sense of these pitches. So then we have Céline Dornier. Céline, please come on stage also. Take a seat. She's the head of investments and international co-production at the Logical Pictures Group in France. She has been working in international sales in different companies, but she worked especially as an international co-producer on projects like The Innocence by Eskil Vogt, which was in Cannes, A Certain Regard in 21, Pleasure by Ninia Timberg, Sundance 21, or Tchaikovsky's Wife, which was in Cannes official competition last year. So I would say she will make it, right? She's a lead producer also on Spectre, except I could go on forever. But anyway, she keeps on working on these bold, author-driven features films, so this is the perspective she's bringing here today. And last but not least, Rain Ranu, he is the investor on stage, but not only the investors. Please take a seat. And Rain, he's a film director also, and the investor in California, based in Estonia, with a very unique background also in filmmaking, entrepreneurship, and also investment, money. You can ask him anything about ratio, I tell you. He is the former founder and CEO of the mobile payment company Fortumo, which was exited in 2020. He's a managing partner at the Estonian-based venture capital fund Super Angel, which is actually an early investor in unicorn companies like Bolt and Pipedrive and etc. Anyway, but as a film director, he's also currently finishing his third narrative, right? Child Machine, Okay, I told you it's a bubble machine. With his latest feature, Chasing Unicorns. And yes, he has his production company, California. So I would say also not a bad match with us, right? Thank you, Rain, to be back here. And let me tell you what's going to happen. So I'm going to call the speaker on stage who is going to pitch for 3 minutes. You know I'm the CTO, so when it is getting like 2 minutes 45, I'm getting up. I'm going to the person, and I push the person off the stage. If they're going, no, I wouldn't do that. No. But anyway, so we're going to do that. Then we have 1 minute, and the jury, the human jury, is giving their comments. We thought we leave it at the end for the AI. It's more interesting, right? And then they can comment the AI results. We just will have a look at it together. I will read a couple of figures. We will have the reaction. And bang, we're going to move to the next one. And we're going to do this 15 times, I guess, today. Yeah? So you're ready? You're excited? It's going to be great. So let's... and I have to add something. It's a total experiment. The jury has no clue. They never did that before. They don't even know the project. So you pitch to someone who has no clue what we're talking about. So articulate yourself. Convince them. Right? Yeah, no pressure. No. and we're going to make it. So, dear audience, if you're ready to go? Yeah. Yes. Okay, let's go. And I call the first speech on stage. I don't need to scream, right? I have a microphone. Okay, so, and it's Penny Adamopoulos, Emmy nominated successful journalist and producer of television and cinema. So, Penny, I know you. I've seen you once on stage. Go on. Oh, the microphone. Sorry.
Okay.
I'm putting
Thank
the timer.
Thank you, AC.
Yes.
Thank you, Juris. Thank you, Sami. Welcome, everybody. And before I start, just take a breath. And as you exhale, feel your heart. The beating heart, the beating drum. This is the feminine essence within you. And this is the story I want to tell you about. It's about a female wisdom, empowerment, and the creative part of us that we thrive in life. Let's go back to Roman time. A young girl called Amora, she's our hero. She's the disciple of Mary Magdalene, who is an Ethiopian Jew, a high priestess of a sacred temple, and a princess, descendant of the King Solomon and Queen of Sheba, and she has a child called Sarah. Pursuing by Roman assassins and trying to survive, they separated for 3 years, and Mary Magdalene and her child Sarah journey to from Judea to Egypt, over the sea, through Gaul, and then end up in Glastonbury, and this is where they start building the first Christian church based on the true Tridic order. The film called Despocini, and it means belonging to the Lord. And it's actually in Greek. We call this Despocini the Holy Mother of God. It's not religious, it's mystical and spiritual, as it brings the self-discovery within you, the magical power you have. This is what we're trying to do with this story. What else am I gonna say? Okay, sorry. I have secured the tax incentives for Greece. I have almost secured the tax incentives in Israel, and we're talking with co-productions in Israel. And I would love from any of you that you love my story to co-produce with me and start to bring the seed money in. The budget is 15 million, and we're looking for 14. So pretty much that's it. See, I'm good. I'm getting better. Thank you, everybody.
Okay. Good, good. So now we have 1 minute feedback from the jury.
I'm going down, right?
You are?
Oh, okay.
I don't know. Is she going on? No, she's staying, right? Okay, you, okay. Stephanie, it's nice with us here. Okay, so let's go 1 minute. Jury.
Are you allowed to ask questions?
Yeah, you can ask questions, absolutely.
On?
Hello, hello. Oh.
Sorry, I think I might have missed your presentation. Is this a period piece?
Yes.
Okay. So, do you think your budget of $10 million is?
Can you speak a little?
Your budget of $10 million is enough to cover this period piece with potential.
15.
Oh, 15. Yeah. Sorry.
What I'm trying to do, this startup company I have called BrightStag, we're trying to be video production, green production, and sustainable. So that's the standards we have. If we exclude the tax incentives, the shooting in Greece and the shooting in Israel, then the most part would be in green production, hopefully, and that's the budget.
Okay, that's the minute. So that's the minute. Sorry, guys.
Okay, no,
so let's have a look at the AI projection. Exactly. So let's go for it. Lead actor, Kristen Stewart. Okay.
We are negotiating.
Yeah, 90%. Yes?
Yes.
Good. That's very good. So total expected revenue, 47 million. Gross revenue to budget ratio, 315%. Total return on investment, 85%, et cetera, et cetera. I don't want to read the slides, right? So I would love to know how the jury is reacting to the predictions and what's your take on that one. Who would like to make a short comment before we move on to the next one?
I can react on the genres. It's really, well, it's interesting for me to see that there is science fiction and horror in it. It doesn't feel like that.
Well, the horror is a little drama, like violence, but not much.
Okay.
It's more mystical.
Okay. More mystical, okay. Okay. Anyone else would like to react?
Yeah, hello. It's super hard, actually. I mean, as an investor, and I invest in tech companies, they have this elevator pitch of 30 seconds, and you had 3 minutes. But still, as an investor, you can only say no after 3 minutes or 30 seconds. And to say yes, you actually have to learn way more. But I would definitely want to see this film, and I would definitely, as an investor, want to get those returns. So I'm curious if Largo has also this machine where you plug in the screenplay and you take out these returns, then that would be a super cool AI product to have. But I would definitely wish you good luck. It looked like a very, very interesting project that
Thank
I would
you.
Love to see.
Okay, well, great feedback, I would say. Thank you very much. And now we have a film producer and virtual production geek, born in Poland but grew up artistically in LA. She's heavily awarded, actually, and it's Karolina Mikolajczak. Please, you're next for your pitch. 3 minutes.
Thank you for a great intro. Thank you, jury, for being here with us. And we have a packed room, so thank you guys for coming. So yes, my name is Karolina, and it is my pleasure today to present you to you our horror thriller feature film, Whistler, the Grassland Killer. Think of it as a combination of Indiana Jones and The Shining. We are in pre-production right now. It is, the main language is English, and countries of productions are USA, Poland, and Colombia. It is based on a Colombian legend of El Silbón, which translates into English as the Whistler. The Whistler is condemned for eternity to carry the bones of his victims. You can recognize him easily by the whistling sound that he makes. The quieter it gets, the closer he is to get you. And then he kills in silence. Did you hear that? So this is the story of Teresa Cordes, an ambitious Colombian-American detective, and a little bit of a hot mess. Her goal is to She has a lot of goals.
Does the jury pick a winner?
Her goal is to prove herself to her demanding boss and to her very conservative mother. And in order to do so, she joins forces with an internationally renowned detective, Greg Macht. Think here something like Sherlock Holmes. So following the clues, they investigate the murders in Los Llanos, region of Colombia. This is where the story is set, contemporary. And they need to overcome local prejudice, deal with terrifying town history, and fight otherworldly monsters. Following the clues, they manage to uncover the truth, yet they fail to stop the killings. Until Teresa hears the whistle herself. And soon she realizes the monster was closer than she thought. And actually, now I will ask for the second slide, please. Thanks to amazing AI results from Largo forecast, our target audience is adult audiences between ages of 18 to 45, males and females. And the budget is set at $1,075,000. With 40% secured, we are here seeking the remaining part of the financing and as well to secure the pre-sales.
Thank you.
Oh, is it?
Yes.
All right,
that
so
was
let's
it.
Go to it.
Yes, exactly. Sorry, that's the rule. Okay. Dear jury, reactions, questions, let's go. Yes. Can we have a new microphone? This one is not working.
Does it work? Yeah, can you hear me? Yeah. So I will answer a great pitch. This is kind of my specialty. I work on genre films, investing on genre films a lot. So I can tell you that this all makes a lot of sense to me already. The budget is really, yeah, it makes sense in terms of genre films and the story. And it feels like from the co-production, you can also raise some soft money, so that lowers the risk. There is a real growing appetite for those kind of films as well. So it sounds... I don't know exactly what you're looking for as an answer, but it sounds like revenues could be pretty high, and it sounds like there is a real potential and a solid co-production.
Great. Anyone want to add anything? Otherwise, we're going to go straight to the AI potential. Yeah? Anyone? No? Good. You can still react after that. It's more secure to react after the AI said something, right? Whoa! Gross revenue to budget ratio 921%.
Here's my second slide. Yay.
Whoa! Okay, yeah. And yes, ROI on the hard money is 385%, not bad at all. Expected revenue 16 million. I think everybody wants to invest in the film right now, right? Okay, so okay, Rain, please, go on.
Yeah, is this like a really optimistic AI? Like, does it do this all the time? Or what's the
okay, okay, well, I don't know, I don't know. How did you program this, Sami? It's has nothing to do with you. Okay, well, that's great. Okay, other reactions, please, Celine.
Yeah, no, I have to say, it sounds pretty, I mean, I will have a positive feedback as well, but maybe not that positive. The numbers are really, really high. It's not, I wish it was those numbers as an investor. It's usually a bit more, a bit smaller than this, but still, I agree with the overall idea of a positive feedback.
Okay, actually, I would like, yes, Sami? Did it take a microphone? Yes.
One clarification. There is one important thing here, the budget assumption and P&A assumptions as well. So
that's right. I should read that. Can you read that?
I mean, I think it's not visible to the whole audience.
Yes, yes.
So that's just
I will read it for
important
you.
Point for AI forecast. I think
exactly.
To look at exactly P&A assumption for the project, just as a note for jury as well.
Yeah, absolutely. So for all of you here, you could not read it. It's there. So budget assumption, 1.75 million, and P&A assumption, 1.7 million. Good. That's it for that project. So we're going to move on. Thank you very much. You can leave the microphone here. And we're going to go on with a trained professional actor, but who is passionate about the business side of film. Well, that's interesting, the mix. He's producing evaluated promotion pictures to break the rules. Well, I want to see on stage right now John Reddington, please. 3 minutes.
Thank you, everybody. Well, this is more stressful than I thought it would be. So I'm here to introduce you to Arizona, an emotionally gripping and socially important feature drama about a family drama. And it's set in Arizona, in the small city of Wilcox. It talks about Captain Samantha Miller, a veteran from the war, closeted gay woman who comes back to the family ranch and starts a love affair with Melissa, her brother's wife. So that's going to be some complicated family dinner, wouldn't you say? When Melissa mysteriously disappears, the illegal meat trade run by the family business is exposed, and leading to a tragic showdown. And Samantha is left to question her own identity. Arizona challenges the conservative values and, challenges conservative values and portrays a family that is torn by gender roles and societal expectations. We're trying to secure Kristen Stewart, Willem Dafoe, and Glenn Close to bring their immense talent to the film and also their critical acclaim. Our marketing strategy includes targeted social campaign, working with influencers and festival partnerships. And the film appeals to drama enthusiasts, the LGBTQIA+ community, and, of course, people seeking for meaningful storytelling. Now, we're at the end of the development phase with a total budget estimated at $7 million. We have already $100,000 secured. And we're looking for co-producers, sales agent, and additional financing, of course. So, yes. Come on with us on this cinematic journey, and let's bring Arizona to life. Let's shed light on important societal issues, and together, let's redefine belonging and authenticity in a world that challenges ourselves. Thank you.
Wow. I love it. I love it. But okay, of course, I'm totally biased, right? Because gender expectations of society, I love to definitely do that. But anyway, let's go and see what the jury has to say about this story. Let's go 1 minute feedback from the jury.
No, I have a question.
Yes.
What is your primary market? So, for example, are you targeting U.S.? I can't really imagine this releasing in Arizona. Is anybody from Arizona?
Yeah, I think Arizona is not the best territory, but
right.
An opening in the U.S. probably. But we were trying to build momentum with a powerful launch in an A-list festival like Cannes. That would be the goal.
Okay. Other feedback from the jury? We still have 30 seconds. Céline, yes?
It's just really interesting for me to see that there is no director, right, on the three projects. So
no, there is, and I totally forgot to mention her, and I'm so sorry, and I feel so ashamed because she's sitting right there.
Whoa!
And I realize that, yeah, I know.
Where is she?
There,
okay. Excellent, okay, fantastic, good.
And she's, she has an amazing vision, so. Yeah.
Yeah, and that's the end of the feedback of the jury. Yeah. Okay. But we still have the feedback of the AI. Hold on, we're not finished yet. Let's go. So I'm reading to you guys budget assumption, 7 million, P&A assumptions, 0.06 million. Well, 60K, I guess. Yeah, what can I say? Total expected revenue, 2.7 million. Gross revenue budget ratio, 40%. Total return on investment, minus 81%. Who said it was an optimistic stuff? Okay, well, that's interesting. So what do you think, dear jury, about all these figures that you can also read here on the monitors. So, Rain.
I mean, I'm still more curious about this AI, like how it comes to the P&A assumption of 60,000, and then comes with up with a project that loses so much money. I mean, would there be like a... Oh, I see.
That's not bad either. 503%
oh,
is written
so
over for
somebody
the
else loses the money. Oh, wow, that's cool. okay. No, I mean, I would love to see that again. I mean, this is a cool movie. I love Arizona, and it would be very cool if
it happens.
That's
a great title in any case, yeah.
That's my feedback.
Yeah, I would love to see the film too. Yeah, Celine, last word.
Just great cast as well, so it also makes sense. It's also an important part with the director. But it makes sense as well. It's great.
Yeah, okay, good. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Next pitch. So now we have Lost Lake Productions with Daryl Tucker, an American film producer, cinematographer, VFX artist. Okay, I'm going to do it faster. Heart House horror feature film, Plague Tone, et cetera, et cetera. You do the rest now, right? Let's go.
Great energy in this room. Thank you all for coming. My name is Daryl Tucker from Lost Lake Productions. I first wish to express my sincere gratitude to the team at Largo.ai for this opportunity to pitch directly on the main stage here at Cannes. Exodus is a live-action virtual production feature film that is for all fans of science fiction movies we loved in the 80s. We're talking Star Wars, Dune, Mad Max, Flash Gordon. It's a visually spectacular, nonstop, action-packed genre movie utilizing revolutionary real-time technology created by Unreal Engine to produce high-quality visuals at an independent film budget. After centuries of war, the Earth is dead. The rich live in an orbiting city while the poor struggle in the wastelands of Earth. Exodus tells the story of Caleb, a young duke whose idyllic life aboard the orbiting city on which he was born is shattered when his mother is murdered by the queen and Caleb is thrown into Earth's apocalyptic deserts. Left for dead, he's found by Red, a warrior maiden of the slave underclass who despises everything he represents. But Red and Caleb must unite forces if they are to stop the queen from vaporizing the Earth. Exodus is written and directed by visual effects veteran and award-winning independent feature film director Dean Yerka. Dean was born in England and has worked in the film industry for over 30 years. He has credits on over 50 major motion pictures. Dean has worked as a computer graphics supervisor on several notable feature films, such as 12 Monkeys, The Edge, and Surviving Picasso. As well, Dean has worked for Industrial Light and Magic as an animator, digital artist, and sequence supervisor on some of the highest grossing franchises of all time, Star Wars, Transformers, Harry Potter, Avatar, and The Avengers. Most recently, Dean has visual effects credits on Disney Plus streaming hits Mandalorian, Loki, Hawkeye, and Obi-Wan. Lost Lake Productions was formed in 2022 by a consortium of independent filmmakers with the mission to create visionary, handcrafted, independent cinema. In my 30 years experience as an indie film producer, I've shepherded several projects from conception through production to successful distribution contracts. My title, The Theater Bazaar, was a critical hit. There was an official festival selection at Sitges in Spain, Fantasia Festival in Montreal, and we were honored to have our US premiere at the Lincoln Center in New York City. We are looking for partners with vision. A $2 million investment will finance the principal production of this film. At that point, we will need publicity, advertising, and distribution. I bring matching funds to the table. The franchise potential, streaming forecasts, and digital gaming rights should also help sweeten the pot. For a full investor trailer on Exodus, please look at our website, Lost Lake Productions. Thank you sincerely.
Wow. Oh. Damn. Okay, good, good. That's great. Okay, so feedback of the jury, and I think I would like to raise the tension. Maybe you want to tell us a ratio for return on investment or a P&A assumption?
Like to guess. No,
yeah, no, not guess. Your own guts. Not guessing, calculating.
We usually make a lot of calculations, Excels and everything, so it would be hard to just guess like this. But I just had one question. It's a science fiction action film. How can it be $2 million budget? What's the magic?
The magic is called Dean Yerka, who works at ILM. He's already built most of the composites and framing, and if you go on our website, you can see the investor trailer.
Yeah, I find this part really amazing, is that that's the really the unique thing here, is that how one really talented VFX guy can use those new technologies that were not available 2 or 3 years ago to build this for a relatively, I mean, very cheap money. So I'm actually very excited to see how it turns out.
Cheers.
Anyone else? No? Okay, let's go. Let's move then to the AI stuff. Ha! Very interesting. So, for those of you who cannot read here, budget assumption, 2 million. P&A assumptions, 0.2 million. Expected revenue, 2.4 million. Gross revenue to budget ratio, 121%. Total return on investment, minus 18. And return on investment on hard money, 65%. And we have a ROI, ROI for investors of 155%. Any comments on that, dear human brains? Yes, Wonsoon, please.
I still agree with Celine. I don't know if the 2 million budget is really believable, so mm-hmm. I disagree with the AI. And I'm sorry, you.
Okay.
No, I love this part, especially that you're trying to do it for a 2 million budget. So I disagree with other panelists. But I'm really curious about this P&A assumption on those projects. Like maybe a couple of sentences, how these are calculated.
Yes, please. You still have 40 seconds.
Let me add on that. So P&A assumption, I mean, so AI is looking at the similar content and what has been the similar P&A. But there is also one thing that sometimes producers, they have the specific distribution deals and they put their own P&A. So if they don't indicate their own P&A, AI is looking historically the past similar films, what has been P&A on that, and then it gives an assumption on that. But it's very important point, P&A is heavily influencing the results, as you might also expect. So it's important to see the results together with assumed P&A, yeah.
Okay. Great. I think it's clear for everybody. Thank you very much.
Thank
that
you very much.
That was the feedback. And now we're going to have on stage someone who had her first appearance on screen. It was a small role, but it was in Star Wars. Yeah, The Force Awakens and Abrams. So hold on. She had only one line, but we don't care. She's great. She's the co-producer of Chopin and founder of the co-producing production company Select Entertainment. Please, Danielle Yen. Woo!
Hello?
Yes.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for being here. My name is Daniel Yim from Taiwan, and I'm founder of Select Entertainment, also the producer of Chopin. Thank you for Largo.ai and the CannesNext for giving this wonderful chance. Chopin is telling the story about the Chopin Wu. Chopin Wu, who come back to the hometown, to the small town America, where he grew up to repair a relationship with the workaholic father, Kurt, played by the Golden Horse Award winner, Liang Dai, with a sudden appearance of his grandmom, who is suffering by the cancer. And Chopin is comforted by the past that he have left behind. In the middle of the health crisis and a broken family, Chopin is forced to re-examine all relationship and embrace the legacy once he denied. And he discovered the importance of the family and also for the identity. So Chopin, this movie is nearly, total budget is $2 million. And currently, actually, we are shooting right now in US, Kentucky. Luckily, we already got intention to work with the distributor from South Asia, Taiwan, and also for the US. And we are still looking for the funding and also the potential partners and distributors in Europe. And if you are interested, and also if you got the DM just from me earlier, please contact with us and also via the Largo AI, and we'll be happy to talk to you. Thank you so much.
Danielle, you still have 1 minute left. Okay. Oh. No, that's fine. No, it's okay. Do you want to say something else? Otherwise, we can go directly.
Remind me, I want to do the selfie after that.
You want to do a selfie? Okay, we will do a selfie. Yeah, okay, we will do a selfie with the whole audience after that. So stay tuned. That's great. Okay, good. Feedback from the jury. What about Chopin? Who wants to take it on? Yes, Celine, please.
One question. Why shooting in the US?
This is a director, Vincent Lin. He grew up in US. So this relates to his personal experience and also inspired by the father.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah.
Other questions, reactions to the pitch on Zoom, Rain? Okay, let's go. Jump to the AI right away. Okay. Whoa, 11 million total expected revenue. Budget P&A assumption, 0.2 million. Really? Yeah, okay. Gross revenue to budget ratio, 646%. Total return on investment, 332. On hard money, 384. And for investors, Rain, look at this, 600%. Okay, yes, you are still wondering what the algorithm did, right? Okay, so what's your take on these AI assumptions? Anyone wants to react on it?
Yeah, no, I mean, it's really interesting.
I mean, would invest on it, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, definitely, sure. But I think, yeah, and especially with, like, such a low P&A, you can get such returns. It's amazing. But,
You know what? Maybe we should change the order the next time. Maybe we do the AI first, and then you do all the comments. I think it will be even more interesting. Shall we do that? Yeah. Yeah? You want it?
And okay. Also, we have the film festival's challenges. Hopefully, it will be world premiere next year in Cannes, so it will be more awareness. And also, we are starring really famous rising star A.D. Lau, and he's a feature in Kung Fu and Silicon Valley, and also a couple of the famous Taiwanese actors.
Okay, so. I let her say that not because it is a bonus, but she was minus 1 minute, so she may say that. Otherwise, she might not. But anyway, Danielle, thank you very much because we are done already. You want to have a selfie? Hold on. Don't move. We're going to make a selfie now.
Can I?
Yeah, okay. Let's do, she still have 40 seconds left. Okay. You know what you do? Do you want me to make the picture with you?
Yeah.
Okay. You stay with me. Don't move. I'm going to make a panorama thing with the jury. So everybody is freezing. 3, 2, 1, freeze. Freeze. Don't move. Freeze. Let's go. Continue. Yes. Stay tuned. Yes. I want you to their main stage. Yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, I will send it to you later, Danielle. I'm stressed myself. So actually, no, I'm not. So now we are waiting for two people on stage. How did they make that to have that done? So we want to have a Swiss and Italian producer and an actor based in London, together with an actor and a writer most known for series of Temple in 21 on Sky One, Cursed, Netflix, My May Destroy You, I'm Scared, 2020, BBC One. So that's Davide Marangoni and Toby King Baccare of Lakeside Pictures. There you go.
Hello, everyone. I'm Davide, producer, and this is Toby, actor and writer of this new, ambitious, elevated horror called Leech.
So the idea sparked from conversations around the influx of true crime documentaries and their recent huge success. Me and writer Sebastian Blanc found ourselves discussing how concerning it is that audiences are really engaging with this content and production companies are putting huge money into it. In a way, we felt like these companies were leeching off people's traumas. But the conversation didn't end there. We felt that as a society, it's becoming quite common for people to do this. Think about Instagram, think about social media. People are on this race for content and sometimes even disregard humanity, disregard people's emotions, disregard people's lives. We actually follow this theme directly in our film with Basha, our lead protagonist, and a production company approaching her and asking to pitch a documentary based on her recent family tragedy. That isn't the only theme we follow in Leech. We also followed the theme of displacement. Displacement is quite close to me because I'm a Nigerian man, but I was born in Ireland in a small town called Lucan. And as you can imagine, in Lucan, the faces were actually quite similar to what we have here, where I was the only black face, and there was a whole load of different faces that weren't like mine. I think it's really exciting to explore that in a film, especially when we're talking about diversity and bringing stories like mine and other people like me to big screens. In our film, we have Basha, who is a Ugandan woman, and she settles in a small Irish town. And this town seems to be friendly and welcoming, but after her family tragedy, we see that things can become sour when people have this sort of search for gossiping, search for, what's the word? Scapegoats, gossiping, and also just this chase for content in general. I'm really excited to bring these themes through the lens of horror because they're not really horrific themes in that sense, but I think when you bring it in that sense, it just makes it better. Sorry, time's running out.
So the film is planned to shoot next year in spring with a budget of about 2.5 million. And although we're still quite early in pre-production, we've already managed to lock away a small percentage of the budget, waiting to be unlocked with the remaining funds. We've also got a great interest from Signature Entertainment to represent the project internationally with an open door towards a pre-sale the moment we manage to secure the cast. And to that purpose, we've already involved a casting director and conversation with the agent is already in the process. Now, this is an ambitious project, as I said at the beginning, but we know we have the skills and the talent to make it happen. And we know this because we've already made another feature that premiered in FrightFest last summer, and as of today, has been distributed internationally as a Tubi original. And although this is just the beginning of distribution, the film's gross profit has already almost doubled the initial investment. So all we need now is just a little trust to help us take this project and our careers to the next level. Thank you very much.
Perfect, thank you, great. Let's have the AI stuff right now, we said. It's okay, right? We adapt to things. So let's have that. Yes. So that we know. Oh, be careful. Okay. So for those who cannot read, budget 2.5, P&L assumption 0.5, total expected revenue 6.8 million, gross revenue to budget ratio 271, return on investment total minus 35%, on hard money 224%, and for investors 126%. That's interesting. So now you can react on the AI or give your questions or give your feedback. You're free. You're more free than ever. So who wants to start? Well, Rain, yes.
I'm personally very excited to see that such a personal, authentic story gets also such high projections from an AI machine. And I feel that films like this one should be made and should be, you know, getting made and getting the returns. So I'm very happy to see that, and I wish you all the luck in getting it done. Thank
you. Céline?
Yeah, I can only agree. Great pitch. And I was just wondering how the P&As work. Like, is it worldwide P&A? Because the numbers are always a bit
Sammy?
Surprising.
Yeah, okay. Sammy, we need you.
Sorry, it's fine.
We said.
Sorry, I had to come to third time for P&A. I think, yeah, we should have explained a bit further. So this is P&A only for box office. So box office.
Worldwide.
Worldwide, yes. And the total expected revenue, it includes box office, streaming, TV altogether. So
why is it so low always?
Yeah, it's pretty low.
Yeah, because actually for many of these films, like big part of the revenue is coming from streaming. So you don't have. So if you think actually with this 6.8, I don't know, but probably maybe like 1 million was only from box office. Even it can be minus because box office, because of COVID, there's a big cut. So if you were putting the box office revenue like in relation with P&A, you will see that you should. So the relationship is not clear. That's since it includes streaming and TV as well. So
okay, really clear now. Yeah, thank you.
This makes total sense now. Yeah. Right. Okay. We still have 15 seconds to answer or to give a remark. Do we want to say anything? No, we're happy? Yes, Vincent, please.
Just come quick. I agree, really great pitch. And I actually want to see this story like fully. I want to hear the ending of the story. So I think it's a very relevant topic to what's happening around the world. So I'm keen to meet with you afterwards and discuss.
Okay, so the humans say, do it!
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, and again, we have a duo on stage, and it will be the CEO and executive producer of Minded and the producer of Minded, and that's David Barrera and Joanna Horn of Minded Productions. You have 3 minutes to tell us more about your project. Thank you.
So nice to meet you. I'm Joanna Horn. I'm the producer at Minded, as mentioned, and I'm here with David Barrera, that will be the director of this film. It's our sci-fi horror film, and David will tell you more about the story.
Thank you. Thank you for the introduction, Joanna. Happy to be here. Signal is called with the script as Solaris, mid-2001, Space Odyssey, and Interstellar, where the core existential and moral conflict of the characters and their struggle for survival. Awakened from private sleep, the crew of a spaceship called Ines realized the groundbreaking space mission was from unique. Humans had beaten to the supposedly undiscovered destination, leaving devastation behind. Determined to uncover truth, Captain Alex Bauman and her team embarked on a mine behind Odyssey across to the cosmos. Passing on a village horrors that challenge their insanity and forced to the comfort their own humanity. The concept for this film is groundbreaking. We will utilize cutting-edge artificial intelligence technology to the shot in virtual studios, crafting breathtaking space scenes and executed grandeur.
Okay, so we're confident about the type of film we want to create, and Largo's analysis has helped us to validate our strategy. Our ultimate goal is a wide cinematic release, and the financial forecast, which you will see later, is giving positive prospects. Our mission with this film is to demonstrate that the potential of European producers to create top-tier sci-fi films that push boundaries. To transform this vision into reality, we're looking for financiers and co-producers that share our vision in this. Furthermore, we would like to attach a sales agent early on, also to help us with the sales and distribution strategies. Currently, we have secured Spanish investment that is tied to the tax credit, but can be used as seed investment. And we look forward to advancing with the financing with the right partners. So thank you for your time and for listening, and feel free to grab us after the event if you have any questions.
Well, can we have please the second slide right away so that we can discuss immediately? And I'm also reading the P&A assumption, and we know why it is so low. It's 1 million budget assumption, K545. Expected revenue 13.9 million, gross revenue to budget ratio 253, total return on investment 5%, and on hard money 98%, for investors 770%. Not bad. Okay, good. Jury, what's your take on this? Questions, remarks, but also advice for these two here.
I'm sorry to speak now. Go ahead.
Yes, go on.
No, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, very, very interesting film again. And I'm still yet looking at a film that doesn't get the returns for investors. So it seems like all the projects here are really amazing. So congratulations and good luck.
Thank you.
Okay. Céline, yes?
Yeah, you don't know how much will be equity yet. So the investors, you don't really know how much it will be because you don't have the co-production yet, right? You're looking for it. So you could raise money, and you have two European countries already. So you don't actually really know about it.
So far, we calculated on the half, since we want to remain as the majority co-producers. So we calculated what the tax credit is in Spain, and we have the investors that cash flow this money in beforehand.
Okay, good. Anything else? No? Good. So, audience, are you good? Yeah? Did you like this pitch? Maybe we involve the audience now. Come on. Okay, good. Thank you very much. And the next one, I'm not going to say much. I'm just going to say the name and the title of the thing because I love it. I don't count. I'm not a jury. Don't worry. If I say I love it, it doesn't mean anything. But it means to me, El Viaje Impossible. This is fantastic. Abraham Lopez Guerrero, please, 3 minutes on stage.
Do you have imaginary friends? No? Do you remember them? I think sometimes that all my friends were imaginary. Okay. Do you remember when was the last time you talked with them? Okay. Well, how what they do when you grow up? They disappear? They vanish? This is an adventure movie made in live action and animation, 3D animation there, okay? It's for all audiences all over the world because imaginary friends are universal concept, right? Okay, the story begins this precise summer where the things began to change. It's a coming of age movie. And we got Noah, which is a 10-year-old boy, okay, who are spending the summer in a village far away from the city, and he lives his perfect life. Everything is nice with his imaginary friends. He saved the world 3 times before dinner, okay? But then he meets Sarah. Sarah is a 10-year-old girl who doesn't need imaginary friends because she is fantastic. She climbs trees, she got goggles to see the stars, and actually she can see dolphins, real dolphins. So Noah has to choose between a stay in his perfect world, but completely impossible, okay? Or begin the first big adventure of life, which is, I don't know, growing up. Okay, so this is our movie, The Impossible Journey. We have a lot of experience doing very, very big movies in Spain. We are the team behind some of the feature films like Klaus, for example, or Dragon Keeper. I finished my movie, finally, my last movie last week, okay? And now we fight a lot of hours, I spend a lot of hours fighting for the projects of other people, and now we join together with our experience in live action, in animation, in VFX, in production, virtual production, and so far, so on. To get involved in our project, The Impossible Journey. So please contact us before the speech and before the selfie, okay? And read the script because it's amazing. If I didn't did that, I say the same, okay? It's a very beautiful story, okay? Not only for kids, but for the kids that you have inside. Thank you.
Okay. Show us the AI stuff. Show us the AI stuff. Okay, total return investment, 5%. Is it the same? No, okay, 5% again. 60 million total expected revenue, gross revenue to budget ratio, 276%. And we have for investors, 250%. And on hard money, 67%. P&A assumption, 1 million. Okay, good. What do we do with this? Questions to Abraham.
I like the pitch, but I'm not sure about the lead actor.
Yes.
All right.
Yes. The
What happened?
The lead actors are kids, so we'll find these kids in 2025 where we were shooting. Because if we find now, they will grow up until then, and they will lose the power for imagining these amazing characters, totally merchandisable. Okay. And that's the reason. That's the reason. But these are the imaginary friends.
He knows who's to sell stuff, right? Okay.
I will talk about P&A again. I won't ask any questions, and I hope Sammy won't hate me. But so from what I understand now, I feel like it should be a bit higher in terms of P&As because it feels like it's a cinema film. It's a theatrical film. So because of the budget as well. Or if it's not, then the budget worries me a bit. It's pretty high.
Yes. Well, it's not high like the movies that are competing with this. You know, we Spanish people are especially to make things seem big with content budgets, okay? So it's about our skills, okay? And I think it could be theatrical. We got a lot of deals now signed. Please talk with Cesar and Gerardo, because they are the producers and they're the clever ones, and they could tell you how is it the project right now. But we got deals signed right now. I touch in my head. So it's possible. It's possible.
It's because, possible,
because, for example,
but it's
some of the movies now, Momias or Tadeo Jones, make these numbers with similar budgets.
Okay, so El Viaje Impossible is possible.
Yes.
Good.
Yes.
Thank you very much. This is what we
have
to this
do. I got more time in my. No, right? I forget to talk about bullying. Bullying. The bullying is one of the conflicts of the movie, and it's important to fight against bullying. Just.
Yes, right. Okay, that's all fine.
Thank you so
thank
much.
You.
Thank you.
Yeah, the microphone, thank you. We need to move on. Yes, okay. I have to push them out of the stage, right? They're really like, I mean, it's nice here upstairs. It's good. So, okay, we now have two brothers, right? David and Eric. And David is a director, and Eric is a film producer, and with a diverse portfolio, showcased and won awards in Cannes, Venice, Sundance, IFA. Okay. 3 minutes, you go, guys.
Hey, can you hear me? Yeah, we're not brothers.
Sorry.
Yeah. I'm Eric, the producer, and this is David Anderson and his brother. Was one of the other filmmakers behind this film. The action comedy, Guy Manley, was created by four friends and is still in progress. And we can reference this film to Nordic breakout films like The Unthinkable, Kung Fury, and Iron Sky. And we're here looking for the right partners.
Yes. So, Guy Manley, A Real Movie, is the story about the super-secret, extremely handsome gentleman spy, Guy Manley, who in his alcoholic retirement gets pulled out by his former boss, Buck Cash, to do one last mission, to assassinate the city's most powerful and richest man, Rich Cash, Buck's older brother. By doing that, Guy Manley will prevent Rich Cash from becoming the city's mayor, avert his ascent to power, and also make Buck Cash the city's mayor. Together with his number one fan, Louis, a Scottish computer hacker, Manley must face against unexpected enemies, old friends, and dive into his own dark, mysterious past as he fights his way through Rich Cash's impenetrable skyscraper, Cash Tower, to have an epic, final, superheroic battle with Rich Cash and his mystical money powers.
Woo!
The whole idea for Guy Manley, A Real Movie, was born out of a desire simply to make a fun, unexpected roller coaster of a movie. The whole project is currently being meticulously crafted by a group of four filmmakers with a shared passion for storytelling and to entertain people. We are certain that our film will captivate audiences worldwide with a skillful blend of action, suspense, and dark humor inspired by the look, feel, and cheesy one-liners of the action movies from the 80s and 90s, with a touch of sci-fi and fantasy.
Whoa.
So the film is nearing completion. We're expecting a release later this year, and with the promising results from the AI-generated results, we are have positive outlook. We are currently looking for 50,000 euros to complete the production, and we have a rough cut and teaser to anyone wants to have a look, and we're here looking for a sales agent and a distributor, and we're also want us. Okay, thank you very much. We hope this resonates with everyone and looking forward to talk to you.
Sorry, who is David?
Yeah,
but you have a brother, Dennis.
Yes, I have a brother. His name is Dennis. Okay, so we're three Andersons in the project.
Okay, so I'm sorry if I was mixing it up. Sorry.
It's totally fine for this time.
Okay, cool. Okay, good. AI, please. Can we have the AI on stage? Let's go. Yes. Ooh, wow. Woo. Wow. Okay.
Are there any women in the movie?
One more time.
Any women in the movie?
Yes, there are. They don't have such a big part, I'm sorry, but there are.
Ay. But the AI seems to like it, right?
I can see there is an advisor and Pakesh. Are they women?
The advisor is the woman.
Sorry. Cool. Manly Tony Lewis. I cannot read it from. Oh, and yeah. Rich. Yeah. Pakesh and the advisor. Yeah, you're right. Good remark. Yes.
I think the budget was a bit low because it's an action film. I would imagine there has to be a lot of costs involving.
Well, you can imagine, but these guys are geniuses. So they did this by themselves, kind of like Kung Fury did it with his own computer and a green screen next to it. This is basically the same thing, but a little bit bigger.
Yeah.
We shot on location. It's not only green screen, I promise.
Okay. And a remark I was asked to say, the P&A assumption is even domestic and not international. That's why it is even lower. So it makes sense. This AI is not crazy. Good.
No.
Any other last comments before I push them out of the stage? No?
I would love to watch the cut, definitely. It's fun. Even though I think that, I mean, it's a comedy, but I didn't think it was too funny, or was it like, can you comment on this? Do you agree with the AI on this line?
As you may have noticed, the AI has a weird taste sometimes, but I think the movie is hilarious. And hopefully you do too.
Okay, cool. Good.
Would love to see that.
Yeah, of course.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, everybody.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, guys. So now we have a dance choreographer and director from the United States who has worked also in France, in Germany, and Greece, and etc. And she was awarded the director shadow position by Blumhouse to begin her transition to directing narrative film. Jennifer Yulkes.
Merci. Thank you for being here. So I'm going to start with a true story. I graduated from California Institute of the Arts as an actor. And shortly after I graduated, one of my cohorts gave some girl who was in the art department at CalArts, who specialized in video installation, my phone number. And she called me and said, hey, I know you're an actor, but I heard you spent 15 years training as a classical ballerina. I have a job for you. And I said, cool. And she said, you need to fly to Europe tomorrow. And I was 21. And I didn't ask any questions, and I flew right into a hornet's nest. So flash forward to the pandemic, I decided to write a TV series about it. It's called House of Culture, and it's, I like to call it a one-hour drama with a side of absurdity. It takes place in the fringe neighborhoods of Paris, France, circa 1999. So we still have dial-up, we still have internet cafes, but we're just at another cusp of the information age boom. And while that politics is going on, a more analog story is happening in a dirty basement on the fringe neighborhood of the 12th arrondissement in France. And it centers around a young American ballet dancer named Jen, who finds herself suddenly caught in a very avant-garde, abstract dance group and realizes it's a lot more chaos than it is actual art. But she doesn't have any money to go home, so she has to stay. And she decides that she's going to give it a shot. She's going to choreograph for and navigate these really charming but frustrating and bizarre characters who know how to do everything except dance. At the heart of every episode, she finds a lot of unlikely friends. She, of course, experiences a lot of sharp betrayals. But most importantly, she learns how to fend for herself and define her worth. I am attached to the actress that I'd like to get, which is Maddie Ziegler. And I'm also attached to a couple of people that I think would make great co-directors with this on me, Benjamin Milpier, and of course, Anne Fontaine, who was a dancer before she became a director. And I'm also attached to Ryan Heffington through Maddie as a possible choreographer. I'm looking for partners in production, probably a co-pro, US, France, definitely shooting here for a big part of it. Thank you.
Okay. And the AI, please. Oh.
That was scary, by the way. Just to dispel a myth, if you've ever been a performer, we, I think, get more afraid of this kind of thing. I'd rather do a triple pirouette for you than this.
But you're a dance choreographer. You can
choreograph. No, this is scary.
Ah, okay, this is scary. Okay, so, we have a different slide today. P&A assumption, 1.5 million to compare with the rest. Streaming forecast, number of households, first month of release. I could have you guess that. Is this normal that we have a little difference here on that one? Yep. Sami, you want to say something
this
about
is
this?
Different.
Yes.
So next five projects are streaming projects. The format a bit different. So we have household prediction, and household is not views, just also for the juries. This is number of accounts that is watching the film at the first month.
Okay.
But typically, you should multiply this at least with number of episodes if you want to reach number of views.
Okay, well, that's interesting, because if we just have a look at the average of 1 million for the number of households first months of release in the United States, okay, that's reasonable. So any reaction about the pitch, the story, anything? Watson, please.
How many episodes will be there?
I calculated this on 10 episodes, so I just did one season, 10 episodes.
Okay. Celine, any reaction? No?
Well, great pitch, great story. I like the fact that it's so personal, and I think it really resonates in terms of themes as well, and the fact that it's really local. I feel like that's what broadcasters are looking for, the fact that you're talking about one culture that can then travel, but I feel from my experience that's what they're looking for, so it's, great.
Very good, okay. Rain, last word?
Yeah, I also like that you're telling a personal story, but in a way that has a potentially very universal appeal. So I wish you good luck getting it made. And
thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. That was great. And we're going to go on with Alexandru Balta of Retina Film Production, the creator of the Spinoza Question, based on the book with nearly the same name, The Spinoza Problem. Let's solve that. Thank you.
Hello? Hello? Okay.
Yes.
Now it's working. My name is Alexandru Balta, as you can read it on here. And this is a very personal, even though it's not my own, but I invested 5 years in it, so it became personal at some point. It's something I would definitely want to chip in at the beginning. But let me get you started on what it is and what you're looking at. So, based on the Spinoza Problem, written by Professor Irvin Yalom, the Spinoza Question is an 8-episode limited series focusing on Baruch Spinoza's excommunication, and Alfred Rosenberg, which was the leader of the Nazi ideology, obsession for this philosopher. We believe this project to be historically accurate, and through our research, we discovered amazing facts about Baruch Spinoza and were stunned when Largo.ai analysis did not find him in its database, which basically gets us to the key of the series, because the key of the series is the Spinoza Problem became the Spinoza Question when we found out that the Nazis were not able to censor his work. So this was due to the fact that Goethe referenced Spinoza, so they couldn't have written him off. And this is what I believe to be the most important part of the story, especially during this troubled times. I do not wish to depress anyone, but, this is where we're at. And the second key to the series is our belief of how contemporary Spinoza was, like with us, not with his fellows, colleagues. He might have envisioned our society far more clearer than, anybody from his era, but the problem was they considered him to be an heretic. So You're looking at somebody who got expelled from every community from which he was part of. And at some point, being despaired, he considered himself to be a free thinker. So I believe to be a free thinker actually values now more than values back in 1600. And this is why Rosenberg's ongoing obsession is why I believe the contrast which Professor Yalom has chosen is, you know, a match made in heaven. And he was initiated into philosophy by Van Anden, who died hanged in Paris, and he was admired by Johan de Witt, whose death is a raw example of what an angry mob is capable of. Sorry, I just wanted to remind all the beautiful people who has helped me throughout this project and Professor Yalom, because it was his idea in the first place, and sorry, I will just get off stage.
Don't leave the stage, but no, it's zero. Sorry.
No problem.
Sorry.
No, okay. No, my fault. I have improvised a bit, so yeah.
It's okay. But that's the rule, and we are clear on the rules.
So, speaking to them.
And actually, too late. I wanted to ask them to guess how much people... Ah, damn, they see it there. Okay, well... Okay, in that case, it is the number of households, first month of release, and as you said, 81.2K. Whoa, okay, cool. P&I assumptions, 10.5 million. I think you're breaking records there after everything we've been seeing before. Okay, dear jury, please. Notes. Shoot. Oh, Ryan Gosling.
Yeah, I was going to ask where... 50 million would go, but now I can see.
Why?
Yeah, now I can see too. Okay.
Well, as a matter of fact, I'm not that much of a producer. I do not have the prior experience. You envision the real budget is all I'm going to say. But I considered looking at other projects, and I've seen that historical pieces tend to have somewhere around 7 to 10 million. So the 50 million is because basically, this is how it added up. I'm not 100% sure I can get them, but this is why we're here, to co-produce and offer the opportunity to anyone who's interested to chip in.
Yeah, and we want Ryan, Ryan Gosling, no? Let's go.
It would be cool, definitely. Yes. I mean, yeah, and I do not want to, you know, hide my enthusiasm on this topic.
I understand.
But definitely, it would be nice.
Okay, that's very good. Anything else? Otherwise, we have the next one coming. We have three left only. So thank you very much.
Thank you. I thank you all. And looking forward to seeing you anytime soon.
Absolutely. So countdown. Yes, thank you very much. Countdown to the last three ones. Oh, my God. Last three ones. Are you ready? So Renier Ronny Beguet from Ridgebridge Production. He's a film producer and a director, and he will tell us everything about the project. I am setting the alarm for 3 minutes. Are you ready to go? Oh, sorry. And we have Stefan, right?
Yes.
You're the composer of the film.
Yes.
I don't have your last name, though, but it doesn't matter. Stefan is great.
Stefan Willing.
Ah, okay, Stefan Willing. Hello, sorry for that. Thank you very much, guys. You go.
Hello, hello, hello. Hello, everybody. I'm a little bit nervous, so bear in mind with me. So my name is Renier Ronny Beguet. I'm from Germany. We are from Germany. This is my colleague, Stefan Willing. And we brought a project today. It's a drama. And the question is, what is love? Love. Where does it go? What do we do if we have love? Does it own us? Or do we listen to other people when we are not in good shape? So we try to think about it, to be more sensitive with this topic. And this is how about the story about this tree.
Yes, when we first started this project, we were asking ourselves, how could we bring our project into the market in a valuable modern way into the industry? It was always a passion, stories to create of people with emotional backgrounds. We tell a story about two people who've been together some time now. Lena coming from a good family and money. Paul, which comes from a criminal background and broken family. They're different in so many ways, but have one in common, their love. After years of separation and lust, she's coming back to Germany. Through a friend, a new job was available. She finds out that the person she had to take care of is nothing but someone she knows. But how could it be? Is it really Paul or someone else? The Encounter is a feature-length drama series based on an original script. The picture is in pre-production, early development of the series, and purchasing private and international equity investments.
So this project is in pre-production, so it means in development. And we need any help from anybody. So it's the we need partners. We're looking for distributors and investors. And whoever is interested in this drama, we would be delighted if you come to us and talk with us about this. And yeah.
Good, excellent. So you can keep the microphone because we're not ready with you. Now, do you want to make some guesses about the number of households before we have? No? Anyone? No? No?
A million.
A million. Okay, let's go for it. Oh, hold on. Yes. 196.4K. It's Germany only?
It's Germany, yeah. Well, the thing is, at the moment, it's just Germany only. And the production in Germany is a little bit different than internationally. One series for one season, and I forgot.
In German?
Episode.
I can't anymore. One episode. It's okay. They will understand.
Okay, one episode is in Germany around 1.7 million to 8 million.
Okay.
For one season.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the average.
Eine Folge is episode.
Folge in German.
Yeah.
Eine Folge.
Okay. Okay, we don't want to discuss languages. Any feedback from the jury further, please? Who is the main actor? Karolina Herfurt. Ah, yes. I mean, I'm based in Berlin, that's why I know the name, otherwise I'm French, you know, but anyway. So, good. Any other comments? Feedback? Nope? No, if we're good, we are tight on time, you know.
I mean, keep going. You have a long way to go from pre-production to actually getting it made. So I wish you good luck and definitely continue on this path. It's exciting.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Okay, great. Keep going. Leave the microphone here, and we're going to go to the last two pitches. Thank you very much. Now, talking being lost in languages, the next one speaks five languages fluently. She was born in El Salvador to German and Spanish immigrants, and she's a multicultural writer, director, producer, actor, Deborah de Sola Habsburg. The stage is yours.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much, everybody, for being here. Thank you, Largo.ai, for providing the space for us. And thank you, the jury, for being here also. I wanted to share a very intriguing story with you. In 1867 is a particularly tragic and pivotal moment in Mexican history. President Benito Juarez is forced to execute Emperor Maximilian of Habsburg in order to secure the independence of Mexico and rid it of Napoleon's imperial yoke. And after discovering that Maximilian was actually his Mason brother, Benito cunningly enacted a plan in order to execute the emperor, but save the man, who later reappears in the Central American Republic of El Salvador under the name of Justo de Armas. Now, I was born in El Salvador, and I grew up with this folklore and mythology of this legend of Don Justo, who everybody said was either a European prince or Maximilian himself. So when later I actually ended up marrying a Habsburg, I was approached by a man called Rolando Deneke, who had spent a large part of his life doing research about Don Justo and finding out the truth behind him. So at first he wanted to have a DNA sample from my husband, and afterwards he was so kind to share all the research and findings from his work. I have to say, at first, my husband and I, we thought it was very bizarre and highly improbable that the theory was true. But upon carefully looking at the research, there were so many similarities that it was impossible to ignore. And we came to the conclusion that if not Maximilian, it had to have been someone from his inner circle. And since then, I have been passionate about telling the story. Mr. Deneke gave me the rights to his research and to his work, and since then, I, together with my co-producer and partner, Mexican director Patricia Regan, we have developed a limited series, which is part fiction, part historic fiction, part Masonic thriller. And we are really excited. We think that the project, oh, it's called The Execution of Maximilian. We think the project has enormous potential because as you've seen, we have Empress on Netflix and Sissy and Corsage, which premiered here.
That's right. It.
Anyways.
Sorry.
Yeah, it's okay. Don't worry, it's
I
your
hate
job.
To
it's your job,
this.
I won't hit you.
I
won't
know.
Hit you.
Okay, good. So now, is it for Germany only?
No, it's for the world.
For
it's
the world?
Streamers.
How many people?
We're looking for
are gonna
a producer,
watch this?
Distributor.
Yes. Okay. Is the AI based on the whole world? Yes. Number? This one?
Yes.
Okay.
It's for US, actually, I think, the results.
Okay.
US only.
US? Domestic.
Domestic.
Okay. Okay, good. 4.7 million. P&A assumption, 10 million. Okay. Feedback, please. Questions. Let's go.
Well, it's harder for us because we are not as experienced in series. So in general, if we don't say much, it's just because it makes sense for us, not because we think the project is not promising. So in this case, I would just say for me that it sounds like it could be a platform type of project, or at least like a studio or a big production type of project. And in this case, I don't really see why the P&As would be high, but it. Yeah, that's just my take on it, and I don't know what you plan to do, if it was supposed to be an independent production, but it sounds to me like it could be a platform.
Yes, absolutely. The idea is that we're looking for a European production and a platform, ideally, to help us make this happen, and yeah.
Okay. Rain, please.
Yeah, I'm just fascinated by the story. I mean, a very personal connection that spans like many, many centuries back. So I'm very excited to see this actually personally.
Thank you.
Okay. Anything else? No good? Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Microphone? Yes. Okay, dear audience, it is the last pitch. Can you believe it? I mean, it went really fast. And this one has a really nice name, I would say, like, Ionescu or Ion Ionescu. He's an independent producer, but also into film exhibition and film distribution. And he's going to pitch for the last 3 minutes. Let's go.
Thank you.
That's the one. Okay.
Well, I'm Ion Ionescu. Thank you for staying and just give me the opportunity to present my project. Thank you, Largo, for having me here. And in a nutshell, there is an 8-part series called Surviving into the Open, based on true historical events taking place in 320 BC after the deceased of Alexander the Great. The territory have been divided between his generals. Lysimach is getting territories from Greece, Turkey, and south of Danube, Bulgaria of today, and three colonies, Histria, Tomis, and Kalatis. Well, those three colonies wants to become independent, and with the help of a powerful union of Thracians, tribes, led by King Dromihete, is helping those colonies for independence. Of course, Lysimach is winning this battle, but vows to go and punish Dromihete's tribe. Well, Dromihete, it's a small army, but managing an unthinkable opposition for such a formidable army, and actually is defending two different fights, one against his son, Lysimach, Agathocles, and second, confronting Lysimach. Thracians, in both instances, are victorious. The series has twists and turns, shatters love, traitors, and events that is taking place from Greece to Alexandria to Minor Asia. And, of course, is not far from mystical circumstances. This is my second, okay.
Finish your sentence.
The first one, I got like 22 million. This is a little bit lower. So they would say, if aim broke, don't fix it. So this is what happened.
Thank you very much. Keep your microphone, because maybe you have some questions here from the jury. We want to have a look at the projection by the AI, please. That would be great, so that we have all the elements to discuss. Can we have the next slide, please? Thank you. This is great. Average 2.7 million in numbers of households, with a P&I assumption by 7 million. Okay. And Mel Gibson as lead actor. And wow, we have quite a few. I cannot read it from here because it is so pixeled. We have a, whoa, intense character relationships here, right? Okay, remarks. Monsoon.
So I agree with Salim from earlier remark that I'm not too familiar with how to calculate these for TV series. And therefore, I feel really challenged. I think I need to spend some alone time with Largo AI later. I have a lot of questions. And I don't understand. So this is also domestic, right? This is also domestic?
US.
Yeah, that's it. Sorry.
Yes, US domestic, sorry. Yeah,
is the AI choosing the actor, or is it you? I have a doubt.
Beg your pardon?
The actor, is it your choice, or is it the AI choice?
I had Liam Neeson, and the AI gave me Mel Gibson.
Ah, interesting. Okay.
Cool system.
That was good.
But I want to mention that the main character, Dromihete, and that's the reason I can afford Mel Gibson with the budget that I have, is having in each episode probably 4 minutes.
Ah.
And it go all the way through the eight episodes. So you can make a deal with whoever is going to be a lower price.
Okay. That's good. Producer talks. Any other remarks on this project you would like to share with us and the audience? No? We're good?
We're good.
Okay, we're good. Thank you very much. You can leave.
Thank you.
Yeah, well, it's okay. You're the last one anyway. So, okay, so good. Well, I would like to, dear jury, can you applause with me for the audience who made it? Yeah. That's really cool. So now, do you have an overall comment about the session? Like your impression? It was the first time you were doing this craze and having all these speeches with such an AI machinery in the background. So how was it for you?
Yeah, for me, I mean, the projects were really fun and cool to listen to. And Largo.ai also seems to be a really good tool for script breakdown and some script analysis. Now, would I, as an investor, base any investments based on it? Probably not yet, because all of the projects were very optimistically returned, investment there. And if, you know, somebody put some money, I mean, obviously, all the projects sounds good, but you cannot put money based on that. So I think on that level, I think AI is not yet replacing humans, which is a good thing for us.
Okay, well, that's a good last question. Yeah, Céline, please.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting as a tool to compare to other films and other projections and other films. First of all, there is one thing that I don't see. For me, the director is always at the center of the analysis because it is film, it is image, it is, well, art even. So that was missing for me, but maybe it's further down with the tool. Maybe it's just because we have the resume. Also, I would love to understand those numbers, which are really surprising. If we were, as investors, making that much on every film, it would be much easier. I think we would know. So, but maybe there is an explanation, maybe there is something, but I would love to dig into those numbers, that's for sure. Other than this, there is something so far we haven't managed to replace humans also because there is a lot that I think AI can't really read yet, or maybe that's it, but it's this emotion or this like relation to, we said a few times that we were touched by some projects that were more personal, and that can't really be read yet by AI, I think, so that's...
Not yet, it seems, yeah, right. Let us see what's developing. Wonsung, last remark or so?
I've never done this blindfolded. So I was petrified of speaking because I'm really scared of the AI and the response. I think, generally speaking, I think Largo has become more friendly this year. Because last year in Cannes, I don't think the projections were that generous from as far as I remember. So maybe their EQ has gone up.
Or maybe the projects are way better. Maybe
that's true.
Let us see. But anyway, I think it's super interesting also for me. I mean, we didn't want to have a complete human versus machine battle, but somehow like it will look like a collaboration, right? I mean, you can still have these results and make a database decision. So that's really so super interesting. So now I have to close the session, but I want to make a last announcement, right? And the announcement is, it's for you who have registered. I mean, you certainly need a drink, and there is a cocktail, a networking event at 5:30, right? Now. Like, now. We are 8 minutes past. We're a little bit over schedule, but I think that we made it in a crazy ride, right? Okay, thanks to the jury. Thanks to you. And thanks to you, Largo.ai. So we will meet now at the Lérens room. The Lérens room for the people who have registered because it is also sold out, like here. Thank you and see you there.
Thank you.
Yeah.